Hey everyone, my name is Matt. Welcome to Reunion. Excited to have you with us for our online gathering. Today we're continuing our series called The Story of God. The Bible is a story, a single unified story about God, humanity, and the world that points its readers to Jesus. In this series, we'll work to understand what the Bible communicates within the context of this great story. Jeff will be continuing the story today, but before we get to him, let me share about the ways you can connect with us. Reunion is one church in two locations with a simple mission of helping people find their way back to God. We believe we are all trying to find our way, and we invite you to do it with us here in community. For those of you who are coming across our YouTube channel for the very first time, let me be the first one to welcome you. We're so glad that you found us online. No matter where you are in your faith journey, you are welcome here. If you are in the Boston area and looking for a community to explore faith with, we invite you to participate in one of our in-person gatherings on Sunday mornings. We have two locations that meet in Somerville and downtown Boston. We also invite you to join one of our many community groups that meet across Greater Boston. Today is a perfect time to join. We're about to start a new season of community groups, and we have a number of groups that meet online, in person, or a little bit of both. You can find all the details on our website, reunionboston.com. If you have your phone handy, also feel free to scan the QR code using your camera, and we'll take you directly to our connection card. Fill out the card and we'll reach out to answer any questions you might have about faith or how you can be a part of our community. You can also follow us on social media. We're on Facebook and Instagram. It's a great way to know what's going on here at Reunion. Now I'd like to introduce Jeff as he continues our series, The Story of God.
Hey everyone, my name is Jeff Oakes and I'm glad to share this message with you today. I was listening to an NPR story on my way home from church a while back, and it was so good that I had to write it down because I didn't want to forget it. The story was about a boy named David Palladino who grew up in an Italian neighborhood west of Chicago. His family was Italian-American, Caucasian, living in an upper-middle-class neighborhood, but David recognized from an early age that his skin tone was different from his younger sister's. His was considerably darker, and his hair was different, too. And the kids in Sunday school would tease him about it. He didn't look like he fit in with the rest of his family when they had their family portraits taken. But his parents swore that he was theirs. When David reached his mid-20s, he discovered that his birth father was actually an African-American man that his mother had dated in high school. David said it was like a symphony surged through his brain. It was both a breakthrough and a relief. And contrary to his mom's fears, David wasn't angry with her. He didn't resent her for keeping this information from him. In fact, their relationship actually deepened and improved as they progressed to a greater place of honesty between them. This young man didn't truly know who he was for the first 25 years of his life. And this missing puzzle piece gave him what he needed to make sense of his experience. It gave a sense of ballast to his life, where before it had always been a struggle for him to stay afloat. Now, he eventually tracked down his father in Memphis, Tennessee, and went and met him. And now he has a healthy relationship with both sides of his family. The knowledge of where he came from was essential to giving David Palladino the opportunity to really thrive. Now, I love hearing that, right? And I realize for every story like his, there are similar examples that give much less satisfying outcomes. But I do believe that there is a truth embedded in David's story that I think applies to all of us. No matter your background or your life experience, until we know where we come from, it's nearly impossible to know who we truly are. We come to a greater understanding of our own story when we learn about the chapters that lead up to our birth. You know, there's that old saying, those who don't know history are destined to repeat it. That doesn't just apply to nations and governments. It applies to each of us. And it's not really just about preventing past mistakes from reoccurring. It's also about understanding your roots, learning from the mistakes of our forebears, and embracing the beauty that we find in their lives as well. How did you get here? Why are you here? I mean, maybe you've been curious about your family background, and so you've purchased a DNA test from like 23andMe or Ancestry.com, and you were just diving in so that you could learn more about your family background. If you've done that, then you know you've done some of this examining, right? Or maybe you find it difficult to look at the past. You're frightened about what might be uncovered there, so you're hesitant to try and dig anything up there. Or maybe you're so disconnected from your ancestors that it feels like any knowledge you learn would just be irrelevant anyway. Now, I don't have the ability to give you immediate family history today. If I did, that would actually be pretty creepy. But I do want to give all of us the chance to discover the truth about the greater heritage that we are connected to. No matter your background or your life experience, we really do come to a greater understanding of our own story when we learn about the chapters that have led up to our birth. And today, I want to take us back to some of the earliest chapters. We've called this message series we're in the story of God, because we believe that the better we understand God's story, the better we're able to understand our story. And so when we see the larger theme running throughout all of Scripture, we come to realize that the Bible is not just a series of random books thrown together with a bunch of disconnected tales about people from the past, but rather it's a sweeping, nuanced, and comprehensive portrait of who God is and who we are in light of him. Your story is deeply connected to this story. Even if, like David Palladino, you were completely unaware of its existence. And just like discovering his own background made a huge improvement in David's life, the knowledge of our place in God's story can give us a sense of ballast that will keep us afloat even in the stormiest of seas. During the last few weeks, we've learned that God created everything, including humanity. He was intentional in making us, and he desires a relationship with us. That truth, if you'll let it sink in, is a stable foundation to build your life on. But we are also complicated creatures. God has given us the freedom to make choices, including the choice to acknowledge him or avoid him. The truth is, we've made a hot mess of our lives and of our world. We have done a lot of avoiding of God and his plan and purposes, but he continues to pursue us. He wants to bring us close. He wants to make us family. Now, what does that mean? What does it look like to be a part of God's family? For that, we need to go way back in history. Our inclusion in God's family starts with a man named Abraham. Only it doesn't, because he was actually born Abram. Now, Abraham was the name that Abraham was given the name Abram at birth. The name Abram is different from Abraham. Abram means father. Terah, who was Abram's own father, gave him the name Abram symbolically. It was with some hope attached to it. There was obviously a desire for Abram to have a family of his own one day. But by the time that Abram was well into adulthood, the meaning of his own name must have felt like more of an albatross around his neck than a heritage for him to enjoy. Abram had no children. He spent the first 75 years of his life with his own name serving as an ironic reminder of this particular fact. It'd be like having an impoverished friend whose name was Rich McMillions or something like that. Or if you were named Joy, but your entire life you battled with clinical depression, you know, it would seem like a cruel joke to be named those things, right? And that was the reality that Abram lived in for almost his entire life. So how did Abram and his wife, Sarai, a childless nomadic couple who lived 3,800 years ago, turn into some of the most celebrated and revered spiritual parents in all of history? Abraham is viewed as the father of three of today's major religions, Christianity, Islam, and Judaism. I mean, 54% of the world's population look to Abraham as their spiritual ancestor. 2.2 billion Christians, 1.6 billion Muslims, and 14 million Jews. How did Abram end up as Abraham? And what significance does any of that have on your and my life nearly 4,000 years later? To begin with, let me give you a little bibliography, a biography on who Abram is. It's believed that he was born around 1800 BC. So he lived about the same distance in time from Jesus as we do. He was 2,000 years beforehand, and we're 2,000 years after. Abram is the first of three biblical patriarchs, the others being Isaac and Jacob, who are the forebears of the nation of Israel. In Abram's life, there are some pretty important moments that I think we want to zero in on together and examine. And the first is his obedience to following God's call. We read about that in the very first moments that were introduced to Abram in scriptures, Genesis chapter 12. It says, "The Lord said to Abram, 'Leave your native country, your relatives, and your father's family, and go to the land that I will show you.' So Abram departed as the Lord had instructed, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he left Haran." This is a simple interaction, and there's not a lot here yet. We're going to learn a little bit more in the next couple of verses. But even here, we begin to see the beginnings of God's response to all that has gone wrong in his creation. You know, last week we examined the fall of Adam and Eve. Their decision to eat the forbidden fruit was a tipping point for sin and death to enter the world. And like a cancer that has metastasized and spread pain and struggle and darkness, God's beautiful creation, with all of its potential, has been deeply harmed. But God's not caught off guard by this. He has a plan to bring redemption and restoration. And through this man, Abram, God will bring into being a nation, Israel, that will become God's own people among all the other peoples of the earth. He will redeem back the world to shalom, wholeness. And Abraham's descendants will collaborate with God to bring blessing to every nation, tongue, and tribe. That word, blessing, there's a repetition of that word in that language that we find in the next few verses. Genesis 12, 2 and 3 declare that through Abram, God's going to work to reverse the effect of judgment on his creation. And the word that's used is bless or blessing. God says to Abram, verse 2, "I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. Whoever curses you, I will curse. And all peoples on earth will be blessed because of you." Now, I want you to step back from this and place yourself in Abram's shoes for just a moment. I mean, if you received a message from God like this, that would be pretty overwhelming. I'm just trying to imagine what that would even sound like or look like. And then you got to put yourself in Abraham's own position, right? He must have been thinking, I'm going to have kids? At 75 years old, my name is going to finally reflect who I am. My life is going to be blessed by God. I'm going to be a blessing to all the people of the earth. That's some pretty heady stuff. But I want to catch something in those verses that I think is important for us not to overlook. From the beginning, God intended his people to be on mission with him. They're chosen not to be a blessing unto themselves, but to be a channel of blessing to others. To bring that shalom of God to the world. To be the missionary people that he was setting them out to be. They would have to be formed and become like the promise that they carry. The whole idea that God wants to do all of this blessing stuff through Abram is actually part of the problem because Abram is a man full of flaws himself. But in spite of all the flaws, God makes a unique covenant with him. He says to him, I'm committed to saving the world. And I'm committed to saving it through your family, Abram. And I'm going to bind myself to that promise. I will save this world. I'll save it through your family. That's God's commitment to setting the world right. And the reason why the Old Testament is so long and storied is because God is saying in those pages, I have vowed to do this, and I will do it. Despite all the flaws of humanity, I'm going to make it happen. For many years after Abram received this covenant from God, his life was more of a reflection of his flaws than it was of his blessing. He was a liar. Abram lied directly to Pharaoh while journeying through Egypt. He claimed that Sarai was his sister instead of his wife, because he thought that that might curry some favor for them and hopefully safe passage out of Egypt. That lie ended up creating some real problems for them once it was discovered. Abraham eventually chose to have a child with Sarai's maidservant, Hagar, at Sarai's urging because they had yet to conceive together. They conspired to do this instead of waiting for God to make good on his promise. Subverted the plan. And that choice created all kinds of havoc at home for Abram and his family. And ultimately, for much of the world, there was enmity between Sarai and Hagar as a result of Hagar's son being born. And today, that enmity still exists between Jews and Arabs, the offspring of Sarai and Hagar. Palestine and Israel remain in deep conflict even today, and it all points back to Abram's choice to subvert God's plan. Abram clearly did not fully trust that God would live up to his covenant. But God didn't retract his promise when he witnessed Abram's lack of faith. Instead, he actually doubled down. In Genesis chapter 17, you read about it. It says, when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to him and said, I am El Shaddai, God Almighty. I will make a covenant with you by which I will guarantee to give you countless descendants. At this, Abram fell down, face down on the ground. And then God said to him, this is my covenant with you. I'll make you the father of a multitude of nations. What's more, I am changing your name. It will no longer be Abram. Instead, you'll be called Abraham, for you will be the father of many nations. I'll make you extremely fruitful. Your descendants will become many nations, and kings will be among them. So God takes Abram's birth name, which meant father, and changed it to Abraham, which means father of many nations. God takes the source of Abram's greatest hurt and disappointment, feelings of failure, and he presses into them even further, turning it into a place of greatest strength and true destiny. God affirms Abram's birth identity, and then he exceeds his wildest expectations. Abraham will become his spiritual identity. And it's not only Abraham's name that is changed, it's also Sarai's name. Verse 15 of chapter 17, then God said to Abraham, regarding Sarai, your wife, her name will no longer be Sarai. From now on, her name will be Sarah, and I will bless her and give you a son from her. Yes, I will bless her richly, and she will become the mother of many nations. God takes Sarai, which means princess, and changes her name to Sarah, which means mother of many nations. She goes from a princess, which is a nice name that reflects beauty, but which also insinuates adolescence or immaturity, to the mother of many nations, all before she's even given birth to a child. And here's the really beautiful thing that I see. You know, as soon as Abram's name is changed to Abraham and Sarai to Sarah, in the very next verses and everywhere else they show up in Scripture, they are just full stop called Abraham and Sarah from that point on. No hesitation, no season of time where they're debating or asking friends for wisdom about this choice or going to their pastor to confirm whether, you know, what God said was true and trustworthy. You know, they just immediately accept and walk in these new identities in complete faith. Now, Sarah wasn't pregnant at the time, and she was still well beyond her childbearing years. But she embraces the new name in the same way that Noah had when he built the ark long before the first raindrop had ever fallen. Complete faith. And four chapters later, in Genesis 21, we read these words. Now the Lord was gracious to Sarah, as he had said, and the Lord did for Sarah what he had promised. Sarah became pregnant and bore a son to Abraham in his old age, at the very time that God had promised him. Abraham gave the name Isaac to the son Sarah bore him. They named their son Isaac, which means laughter. I mean, you can imagine the joy and the laughter in their home as Abraham and Sarah name their son and experience the fulfillment of that promise, right? A covenant has been confirmed against all the odds, in spite of all their own flaws and mistakes. After years of doubt and frustration, God fulfilled his promise, a son. That's a pretty fantastic story, right? I mean, you're probably thinking, that's beautiful, Jeff. I mean, it's really sweet. How in the world does any of this apply to me? I mean, realistically, most of us do not trace our roots back to the ancient Middle East. So why are we talking about Abraham today as though knowing his story makes a difference in ours? The amazing thing about Abraham's story is the concept of adoption into the family of God that it brings to us. God decides to make Abraham a father, and ultimately the father of a people that will be identified as God's very own. I mean, the nation of Israel is birthed in the moment that God grants the son to Abraham, and it becomes this incredible heritage for Abraham, right? But in order for that to happen, God had to adopt Abraham in, along with all of his descendants. God chose to bring Abraham into the fold, right? And God continues to do that work today with us. I mean, let me be clear. There's only ever been one immaculate conception. You know, God isn't dispensing divine pregnancies left and right, which means that none of us can claim that God is our biological father. Jesus is the only one with that designation. And yet, here we are. We're called brothers and sisters in the same family, fully and wholly adopted into the family of God. That's news that can completely change your understanding of God and of who you are too. God wants to adopt you into his gracious and loving family. You get to be a part of the same blessing that Abraham received from God. In fact, that blessing is available to all people of all races, all languages, every tribe, every tongue, regardless of every manner of flaw or misjudgment or mistake in us. Just as God made good on his promise to Abraham, in spite of Abraham's lack of faith, our flaws, our lack of faith, can be overcome too. How is that possible? How does this happen? You know, the lineage from Abraham to Jesus is long. There's 2,000 years of history there. But Jesus is the promised one who allows us to be grafted into the family. In Christ, God has shown us the lengths to which he is willing to go in order to make us his own. A plan that he put in place all the way back with his covenant to Abraham. Make no mistake, our flaws, our waywardness, our disobedience divide us from our Creator. I mean, that is the story of Israel. The nation of Israel were not faithful to God. They would go through seasons of faithfulness where there was obedience and deep relationship and connection, but so often they were unfaithful to God. They were an example of what it looks like to walk away from God. And our sin, our own choices to do our thing instead of God's thing, really become an insurmountable obstacle for us. And so God does what only God can do. He sends his son into the world, the offspring of Abraham, not only to show us the love of the Father, but to lay down his life for us. God in the flesh mingled in with the people of Israel, and Jesus grows up to take the blame and the punishment that all of humanity deserved upon himself, so that we have the opportunity to be forgiven and welcomed as sons and daughters. He has chosen to adopt us in spite of our flaws. And he paid the price for that adoption with his own blood and tears. Now, all we need to do to receive that gift is to follow the example of Abraham and Sarah. Trust God in faith. Believe that Jesus is your Savior. Allow him to do for yourself what you cannot do on your own. Trust that he can make you whole and adopt you in. You know, the world is constantly trying to tell you who you are and where you fit in. The culture we live in, those outside, they're pressing in with their understanding of who you should be. I mean, for David Palladino, his peers excluded him because he didn't look like he belonged. Some of us in our lives have been excluded in the same way, maybe just for different reasons. We're told that we don't measure up, that we don't have what it takes, that we're incapable of ever really fitting in. Just as Abram's birth name was hanging over him as an emblem of his own inadequacy, some of us have allowed the world to name us and label us as inferior or substandard. I mean, the world will tell you that you're defined by what you own. You'll never own enough, or by how much authority that you have at work or in your life. And you can never rise high enough not to really matter. or by how well behaved your children are, you know, and they never seem to behave good enough, or by how many degrees you've attained and the prestigious schools that are on your resume. But there's always something that seems to be missing from that list. Sometimes we're defined by how many exotic vacations that we get to go on, and yet there's always some destination that we can't seem to hit. You know, we need to resist being named by the world and their expectations. The world doesn't know you. Instead, we need to go to the Father and ask Him, who do you say I am? What's the name you've given me? It's easy to listen to the world and be discouraged. It's easy to listen to deceitful words that the enemy whispers to us, just like with Eve in the garden, hoping that we'll allow those to take root and to grow and metastasize in our bodies. You know, if I gave you a few moments of quiet right now, I bet you could write down dozens of lies that you've likely believed about yourself. Maybe some of them for most of your life. Liar, cheater, fat, lazy, cheap, unworthy, broken, irredeemable. I did this exercise once. Not super fun, but shocking how quickly the words came out. Do you know what it takes some real work to achieve? It's learning to listen to the voice of God amidst the sea of other voices and to trust that what He says is true. I'm sure that was the case for Abraham too. And God knows this about us. It's not a mystery to Him. There's something so important in our text that I just don't want you to miss today. In Genesis 17, when God makes His covenant with Abram and changes His name to Abraham, He introduces Himself for the first time as El Shaddai. God not only changes Abraham's name, He reveals a new name for Himself too. In our text, the name El Shaddai is translated as the Almighty God. And that's certainly an acceptable translation. God is almighty. Full stop. He is. But the name in Hebrew is actually much more nuanced than our English can really fully encapsulate in a concise way. In Hebrew, El Shaddai really means the God who is more than enough. He's not just almighty, not just the all-sufficient one. No, He is more than enough. Never forget that. The God who is more than enough has chosen to adopt you as His child. He wants to bless you and use your life as a blessing to bring shalom into this world, into the people who come into contact with you. He's brought wholeness into your life, and He wants it to spread. You are not your own. You are God's child. And He is sacrificial in His love toward you. He's patient too. And sometimes it might seem like He's slow to make good on His promises. God is not beholden to our timetables, but He is never late and He never fails. You can trust Him. You're His family. Let's pray about that. Father, thank You for welcoming us into Your family. Not because of anything deserving in us. I mean, we are as flawed as we can be sometimes. But it's out of an abundance of Your grace and love for us that You choose to graft us in through Jesus. I mean, in Him, we find the source of our adoption because of His sacrificial gift, His exchange of His perfect life. for our imperfect life. He clothes us with his holiness. And so, Father, we want to just trust that. We want to accept the goodness of that. We want to be your kids. So remind us each day how much we need you, that you are the God who is more than enough for us. We can be fickle creatures. So with your Spirit at work in us, help us to become the blessing in this world that you intend for us to be. To be the sons and daughters, the reflection of your heartbeat in this world that you intend for us to be. Father, that is our desire. Help us to be shaped and formed into your likeness. And give us a faith that allows us to rest in who you are, our Father. We pray that in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to move to a time of communion like we do each week. And I just want that theme to flavor everything that you think about for the next few moments as maybe you go to your own kitchen and grab something that can serve as bread and cup. And as you taste the goodness of God, be reminded he is a loving Father. As a loving Father, he sent his own Son to lay down his life for us. Think about that. Think about the challenge of a father giving up his son so that he could invite a broad group of people like us to become family. And that is an incredible love that he has. Jesus puts it on full display at the cross. And so we remember him and we acknowledge that we need him. We place our faith and our trust in him. We repent of times when we've been willing to go astray, willing to avoid the good news of what he's done. And we realign ourselves with our dad and our Savior who loves us so much. Let's remember them. What they've done for us right now.
Soften my heart. your spirit strong in the end. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. And I may be weak, but your spirit strong in the end. My flesh may fail, but my God, you never will. Give me faith to trust what you say. That you're good, your love is great. I'm broken inside, I give you my life, my life. I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me, and my flesh may.
Let's close with our benediction. Loving God, we ask you to reveal yourself to us in a myriad of ways so that we can truly know you. May we understand you and your wisdom so that we know you with our intelligence and our minds. May we experience you and your kindness so that we know and love you with our emotions and our hearts. May we feel you in your mysteries and truth so we know you in the deepest part of ourselves, even in our bodies. We ask with the entirety of our being that we know your presence today and carry it outside this time and space. In the name of God, our Creator, Jesus Christ, our Savior, and the Holy Spirit, our breath of life. Amen. Go in peace and live the church.